Breaking news, one Republican senator warning, get ready for anarchy if President Obama takes executive action on immigration. Senator Tom Coburn warning it could get violent. And other Republicans also are on the warpath, claiming this is President Obama's biggest power grab yet. And get ready, because it is coming. In a video posted to Facebook, the president announcing that he will take executive action on immigration, and he will tell the nation all about it in a primetime speech tomorrow night.
What I'm going to be laying out is the things that I can do with my lawful authority as president to make the system work better.
And he's expected to sign an executive order this week that may legalize up to 5 million undocumented people.
What Obama is about to do is write a law all by himself.
What the president is suggesting is tearing at the very fabric of the Constitution.
I'm not the emperor of the United States.
I'm almost speechless here.
I'm excited about the courage of this president.
The American people don't support amnesty.
This is not amnesty.
We can now soon add the issue of amnesty to the long list of lies told by the president.
The president cannot write law. The president can't make it up.
And Senator Rand Paul joins us. Good evening, sir.
Hey, Greta.
Well, the president says he's going to make an announcement tomorrow night, 8 p.m., about an executive order about immigration. I take it you don't like this.
Well, you know, he said 22 times previously that he doesn't have the power to legislate on his own on with regard to immigration. So I hope he keeps that in mind when he comes forward to do something different. No, I think he has absolutely no right through executive order to write new immigration law. So I am very much opposed to it. I'm open to some form of immigration reform. I'm open to expanding work visas. I'm open to a lot of ideas, but the president can't do this. This goes against the fundamental separation of powers that we have in our country.
All right, well, the judicial branch can review an executive order, so there may be, you know, some other branch of government could take a look at this. But in the meantime, what do you intend to do? Because he's made it very plain what he intends to do.
Well, it's difficult because if Congress rebukes him, and right now we have a Democrat-controlled Senate, which is not going to rebuke the president, but let's say even in January we decide to rebuke him with legislation, he could simply veto that. But I would say that there is a case from the 1950s, the Youngstown Steel case, and in that case, the Supreme Court said to Harry Truman that he had done something unlawful through an executive order. And this is kind of rare, but they said there are three kinds of executive orders. One executive order is to execute the law as it was intended, and there's no conflict with Congress. One type of executive order, it's murky and it's unclear, but then there's an executive order that directly contradicts what Congress wanted. So what I would recommend to the House is they should immediately pass at least a resolution saying that what he is doing is contrary to the will of the House of Representatives. That would set up, I think, a very clear-cut case in the court, and it may take a while to get him. But the thing is history will treat him unkindly on this if he thinks he can become king.
You know, the whole idea is like in Washington, people are always worried about their reputations. History will treat them unkindly. But these orders, whether you're for them or again, have real impact on people. It's not who's the hypocrite, who's not the hypocrite, who can do something. It's what, you know, these have a real impact. And I'm curious whether you think the House should have voted on the Senate's immigration bill that was sent over about at least a year ago.
I've always been in favor of securing the border first, doing some things to increase work permits. For example, there's a couple of bills that are very uncontroversial, and I'm for passing them immediately in January, and I think we may do this. Visas for people with a master's degree or a PhD in math and science, they're being gobbled up by other countries, and we would love to have them in Silicon Valley or in Texas and Austin and different places at our universities teaching. We want those people in our country, but we don't have enough visas for people that have these great skills. A bill passed in the House last year, but the Democrats have basically held it hostage and said, unless we get everything we won't give you part of what would be good for the country. So I think what will happen when Republicans take over is some good things that there is overwhelming support for, like increasing visas for people with college degrees in math and science. I think that will happen immediately, and we'll see, is the president willing to work with us to get part of what he wants, or will he insist on always getting everything he wants?
Well, we'll be watching tomorrow night at 8 p.m. The president will speak to the nation. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Greta.
So why now? Post-election, lame duck, and of course it is true President Obama has been threatening to bypass Congress on immigration for a long time. So why announce executive order just days before a holiday week? Joining us, our political panel, The Hill's A.B. Stoddard, The Washington Examiner, Susan Ferriccio, and The National Journal's Ron Fournier. And Ron, of course, even more coincidentally, it's the night of the Latino Grammys.
What a coincidence. I think the White House communication staff, right, actually, I know, they're kind of patting themselves on the back. They think they've pulled off some cute little micro-targeting here, because what's going to happen is the president will speak to the Hispanic community through the Grammys. They're going to pause the Grammys and let him speak. And the major networks aren't planning on carrying it. So the people who are for what he's doing, barely, by the way, we should get into the poll numbers, are going to see him, and the people who are against it aren't. And it's interesting in the poll numbers, almost 60% of the public is for immigration reform. But only 38% think the president should do it by fiat. And interestingly, of the Hispanics, only 43% of Hispanics think the president should do this by fiat. So what he's doing is politically not very popular.
Big picture timing, this is a really optimal moment for the president to make this decision. We are days away from needing to pass a big government funding bill. The GOP is right on the edge of taking over Congress. Everybody's watching Republicans. What this is going to do is going to force the Republicans into a big fight over how to respond to this in the spending bill. So it's kind of a win-win. He's getting it done before the end of the year, as he promised. And he's doing it in a way that's going to highlight divisions within the Republicans that will favor the Democrats, make them look like the ones who can lead, and Republicans like the ones who talk about shutdowns and impeachments and in fighting amongst themselves. So I hate to be a real cynic politically, but you know that this factored in when they talked about whether to do this now or whether to wait till after the government funding bill passed.
Plus, the big spotlight is always the media, and the media is just standing by, AB, wondering to see if Ferguson, Missouri is going to, you know, implode or not. Because then all of a sudden, you know, if there's huge riots, yeah, it's immigration.
It will be lost. Exactly. That's very interesting timing. But I think Susan's right. The Democrats actually are disappointed in the timing. If you talk to Democrats in the Congress who would be generally supportive, they wanted to get the spending fight, like Senator Harry Reid, the majority leader who's still in control of the Senate for another month or so. They wanted the spending fight to pass before this happened because it could be the position that the Republicans put certain riders into the spending bill, and Democrats are seen as shutting down the government if they don't agree to them. So there will be pressure for Democrats to criticize the announcement because it was done by fiat, to join in with zeroing out funding to keep the government open, and there will be some pressure on Democrats. It is also true what Susan says, that President Obama, I think, feels he has nothing left to lose and is happy to invite Republicans to be on the record supporting deportation, opposing deferred action, and on and on.
We're missing the big picture here. We're all assuming Hispanics are before this. If right now we don't have a majority of Hispanics who want him to do this by fiat, we could very much have in the next election the same thing that happened this election, which was, of course, Hispanics are not going to vote for Republicans, but they could stay home. They see, a lot of them already see this as pandering.
And of course, the whole thought that, you know, why didn't he just wait and work
after December 11th?
Right.
Why?
Well,
why not wait a couple more weeks?
Why does he get hit the move?
I like the Grammys tie in there, Ron, but I think he's got the answer.
Or why, when he had control of the Congress, why didn't he give him immigration reform that was durable then? Or why not get bipartisan
immigration? Or why didn't he wait until January? They had a White House meeting. John Boehner proposed.
Why didn't he do it when he had the House and the Senate?
That's my point.
Not waiting until January. Didn't want to wait a couple months.
Hispanics know when they're being pandered to, when they're being used politically, and they can see through this.
All right, panel, stay with us, and here we go again. Obamacare architect Jonathan Gruber calling all of us stupid, and more than once, but it just got even more insulting. Gruber voicing over a cartoon to explain Obamacare to what he considers stupid Americans. That's right, a cartoon.
I'm Jonathan Gruber, an economist at MIT who served as an advisor for both the Massachusetts and the National Healthcare Reform Bills.
Lack of transparency is a huge political advantage. And basically, you know, call it the stupidity of the American voter or whatever. But basically, that was really, really critical to getting the thing to pass.
We know the ACA can succeed because it's based on a successful reform in Massachusetts.
Ted Kennedy and smart people in Massachusetts have basically figured out a way to sort of rip off the feds for about $400 million a year.
It's a very clever, you know, basically exploitation of the lack of economic understanding of the American voter.
The ACA makes affordable health care a reality for all Americans.
The American voter is too stupid to understand it.
And Representative Trey Gowdy joins us. Good evening, Mr. Chairman. Nice
to
see you.
How are you?
Your thoughts about Mr. Gruber, and now he's got a cartoon to, I guess he thinks adults are so stupid, kids aren't buying health care, but parents are. They must need a cartoon.
I prefer SpongeBob, but I did watch his cartoon earlier today. I can't get past the irony to get to the arrogance, and there's plenty of arrogance. But when an administration holds itself out as the most transparent ever, and then you confess that you have to use artifice and deception to pass your signature piece of legislation, and then you insult the voters in the process, who, by the way, threw out your party summarily a couple of weeks ago, and you're still getting public money to continue the indignities and the insults, shame on us if we don't do something.
Well, and this is the thing that's interesting about in his cartoon. In his cartoon, he says, in part, that he knows that the Obamacare will succeed because it's based on successful reform in Massachusetts. Massachusetts was successful because it got a $400 million grant from the federal government. The Obamacare, this nationwide health care, isn't getting a grant from anybody.
Right. I saw that today. I mean, he was bragging about essentially getting the rest of the country to pay for the Massachusetts health care plan.
And then that's the sort of the successful model.
Right. Well, there's no place our country can go to dupe somebody into giving us $400 million.
Which is why he probably thinks we're stupid if we bought that.
You know what? I think people showed that they were pretty smart a couple of weeks ago. And I think anytime you base any piece of legislation on the fact that your voters aren't going to read the bill or aren't going, you believe they're not going to understand the intricacies of the bill, that's dangerous for a participatory republic.
So what happens? I mean, whether you like Obamacare or not, you got to hate the way this went down. I mean, nobody read the bill. It was incomprehensible. I tried to read it myself. And now you've got them admitting that they use lack of transparency to get it passed, that they think the people are so stupid that they could slick the people.
Well, when you have an insomniac with Tourette syndrome, you don't interrupt him. So we're going to let him keep talking for as long as he will talk. And then when he's through insulting our fellow citizens, then we are going, what I would recommend to the Speaker and others is have a series of congressional hearings primarily that focus on the money that we spent on him. I would love to ask him, when you apologize, did you apologize because you said it or did you apologize because you meant it? I mean, I think he meant that we could not have passed this bill if people had been
but
paying
see,
attention.
That undermines the democracy. I mean, the insult's a big deal. I mean, people say nasty, rotten things to each other all the time. I'm okay on that. I mean, it's pretty arrogant what he did. But what's even more disturbing is to undermine the democratic system by being deceitful knowingly to get something passed. That's different.
But Greta, when somebody is so much smarter than we are and knows so much better what's in our best interest, and they happen to have a PhD behind their name, it's okay when they lie to us because they have our best interest in mind, and you and I just are not smart enough to know what is best for us. It is the arrogance. If I could get past the irony, I would get to the arrogance. But this transparent administration can't tell you the truth about a signature piece of legislation. That irony is just rich to me.
Congressman, nice to see you. Welcome
yes,
back
ma'am.
To Washington. Nice to see you, sir.
Thank you.
And developing now, Jonathan Gruber is stepping down in Vermont. You saw it here first last night when on the record report that Jonathan Gruber has a $400,000 contract in the state of Vermont and some not-so-happy Vermonters. Well, we have no idea if our reporting had any impact, but news just 24 hours later, Jonathan Gruber is quitting his health care consulting job with the state of Vermont. Here's what Vermont Senate Minority Leader Joe Benning had to say about Gruber today.
When you are coming to a group of people who are paying you a large sum of money to try to have something accomplished, and you treat them with disrespect, that leads, in my eyes, to a situation where he is not going to be credible when he tries to come into the legislature to sell whatever package he develops.
And Fox News correspondent Doug McElway is live in Vermont. Doug.
Hi, Greta. Hard to tell if this decision was long in planning or if it was something that came up very suddenly. It came in the form of a telephone call from the governor's office, from the governor's point man on health care to Gruber, who said that he had become so toxic, in effect, that they could no longer work with him. Under the terms of the agreement, Gruber will no longer be finished the pay of his $400,000 contract. He can keep the $160,000 that he already earned. Unclear whether he's going to continue to work on the contract in Vermont or turn it over to his research assistants, who are paid $100 an hour, far less than the $500 an hour that Gruber made. But long before Gruber became so toxic, the health care plan in Vermont was toxic in and of itself. There had been lots of missed deadlines, lots of accusations of missed deadlines, and also of a toxic nature of the entire plan, a lack of transparency on the part of the governor. He won re-election in November, by the way, by only one percentage point over a no-name, poorly funded Republican candidate. Neither candidate garnered 50% of the vote. So January 8th, the legislature is going to decide who the next governor is. And it may be that the incumbent, Peter Shumlin, did not want that name, Jonathan Gruber, hanging over his head with that vote looming. Got it back
Doug,
to you.
Doug, thank you. And on the record, and Fox News have been telling you about Jonathan Gruber ever since his first of many videos surfaced. So is the mainstream media largely ignoring the Obamacare architect controversy? And if so, why? Our political panel is back. Susan, to you, is Fox News making too much out of this Jonathan Gruber, or is this important?
You know, ever since this story broke, the first thing I thought of was the video of Mitt Romney and the 47%. Remember during the campaign, that secret video was revealed, and the media went crazy. It was nonstop coverage, wall-to-wall coverage of that video, and the response to the video, the reaction to the video, the poll numbers relating to the video, all the things. And this reminds me of that. We're seeing a revelation that from someone close to the administration about the health care law that appears to be a deception. In the same way people felt Mitt Romney may have been deceiving them about what he really thinks of the voters. Yet nobody is paying any attention. And this is the major health care law.
I don't think I would just say one thing. I don't think he was close to the administration on this. I think that he was the architect.
You know,
he's in the brief that's
right.
just been filed to the Supreme Court, a petition.
He is
so thick into this.
That's the problem, is that the administration has really not been forthcoming about their relationship with him. He was mentioned frequently in a presidential campaign in 2012 because they used Gruber's involvement to deflect criticism of Obamacare, saying it was Romneycare light and that he had been the architect in Massachusetts. So what's Mitt Romney doing picking on Obamacare? He was paid $400,000, and your viewers should know that's a lot of money in this town. There are not congressional or White House staffers making $400,000. No matter
and that
how
was
much
just starters. When you add it all up, it was...
And he was in White House in presidential meetings, presidential level, president present at meetings. You just don't get there unless you're influential. So the fact that Senate Democrats, House Democrats have not come to the cameras and said, we were not deceiving the American people, we did not do it that way, and I don't, you know, and I disagree with what he's saying, we're not hearing that. And we're also not hearing from the White House, a rejection of his criticism, but an acknowledgement that he was a part of the process.
Right. According to our reports, CBS has done 4 broadcasts, NBC 1 broadcast, ABC 1 broadcast on this.
Yeah, look, I don't care if the president is from the Red Party, the Blue Party, or the Green Party. When the White House is caught lying about the liar and the lies, which is what's happened here, that should be a big story. And I would equate it to, there's obviously no equation between health care and a war, but if we can remember when it was found out that the Bush administration was paying ex-generals a lot of money to go on TV and sell and inflate the need for a war. It was a huge story on the front page of the major newspapers. And it was the same kind of story. It was the administration spending taxpayer money to promote its policy and to deceive. We ended up realizing we were deceived on the Iraq war. I don't know if it's because most newsrooms are a little bit to the left, so they tend to give Democrats the benefit of the doubt. I don't know if it's because of a misperception that the health care law has been settled. I think it's a misperception. I don't know if it's because Gruber was a source for so many journalists. But for whatever reason, we're missing a big story.
And panel, thank you very much. And developing right now, we have more ISIS trouble. It is about their weapons. Colonel Oliver Norris is here next. Plus, I just found something very odd. It is evidence of something that's been going on since I was in the third grade. All right, the inside story about me coming up.